Hi, I'm Phil Hodgkinson, and you're listening to...
And he takes that chance! Right now! The fairy tale season has the happiest ending!
Welcome to episode 50 of the Andy Takes That Chance podcast. As we raise our bat for our half century, we also raise a glass as we're coming to you live, or not live, from Magic Rock's tap room in Birkby, Huddersfield. Tonight we carry an injury list as excessive as Huddersfield Town, so in our hour of need I have three craft ale aficionados who, in the style of Magic Rock beers, jumped at the chance to come to the pub and share common grounds. So with me, your ringmaster, Matt Shaw, I have a man well known to those in the Cowshed loyal. It's El Gingero, Dan Pozzoporit.
Evening, everybody.
How are you doing, Dan?
Yeah, not bad, mate. Yourself?
Not bad. What are you drinking?
Am I allowed to say that?
Yeah, they're our sponsors. You can go for it.
It's a fine German ale.
Very good. Also in our Circus of Sour, making a podcast debut, I've got the human cannonball, Josh Quirk. Hi, Josh. Are you okay there?
Not bad, mate. How are you? Cheers for having us on.
Very good. What have you got there?
Nice Highwire, I think. A little bit of grapefruit infusion going on. So, yeah, it's not too bad.
Very nice. Nervous? You see you playing with your hands a bit?
I always do it, mate. Always do it. Don't worry about it. It's fine.
Very good. And completing the quartet, we have renowned Huddersfield Town match reporter, the man of Ryperbole, the rock star, Martin Sykes. Good evening, Martin.
Good evening, rock star. I'm just regretting calling Danny G podcast boy a few years ago when he started doing this now. So
you're in the clique.
Sorry,
now.
Sorry, Danny.
You are fully in the clique. Right, as I turn your volume levels up, we'll carry on. So you might have noticed that my intro there contained a load of Magic Rock beers. That's what I was doing with my intro. So just be thankful that I didn't use Salty Kiss or Clown Juice.
You'd have loved that, to be fair.
I always enjoy your intros, Matt. Very, very well thought out.
Thank you very much. Right, so this podcast is sponsored by Magic Rock, as you might have worked out already. What Magic Rock like us to do, or what we like to do in partnership with Magic Rock, is we like to promote the Welcome Centre. It's coming up to Christmas this time of year. The Welcome Centre have two blue bins at the start of Magic Rock as you walk in, and I'll put a picture on our Twitter feed as well. If you ever pop down to Magic Rock and you can spare maybe a can of food or some warm clothing, please bring them down and pop them in the bin, because that will go a long way for the people of Huddersfield in the Welcome Centre. So thank you very much to those of you who do that already. So let's start with a painful one. I'm afraid it's... you know, in fact, I'm going to go back to some happier times.
But Leeds gives it straight to Moy again, who shoots. What a goal, Aaron Moy! An absolute thunderbolt delivered all the way from Australia.
So that was happier times there, but not so much on Saturday. Huddersfield Town 0, Leeds United, aka the Chesties, 2. Town shorn of 10 or 11 players for one reason or another, had to start well. I thought we came out of the blocks very well. I thought we had to set a high tempo to match Leeds' high press and their speed and precision. We did that for 40 minutes, I felt, and then physically I could see that a lot of players on the field started to tire a little bit. And I think Leeds' second half physical fitness and probably the lack of cutting edge.
Just the extra bit of quality there.
A little bit of extra quality just made for them winning 2-0. But I'll be honest, I thought... we started the second half slowly as a consequence of tiring at the end of the first half, and they caught us cold. And once you go 1-0 down against Leeds United, it's very, very tough. But, Dan, we missed, four chances, really, second half. And I argue that we probably, on balance of play, although our quality probably wasn't as good as theirs, we probably deserved a point at the end of the day.
Yeah, I fully agree. I think I said after match coming out, it was probably one of those where if someone had told me that Town... weren't the better side, I'd be looking to correct them, but I wouldn't be looking to correct them in the fact that we were the better side. I think we were pretty even throughout first half, as you say. I think we were probably the on top for most of it, although not really creating too many clear cut chances. I think I remember Mounier with a decent header.
Grant had one off the line, didn't
Yeah, and the header sort of
ailing,
yeah, about 6 yards out after a bit of a mix up in defence. I thought we were. We were good, we closed them down, we played with a lot of enthusiasm, which I fully expected after what happened at Bristol. A lot of new players coming in, you know, putting a stake in for the shirt. I said again at half time, we really needed to score in that first half to go in at 1-0, yeah, really. I couldn't see us keeping that up for a full 90 minutes. Always thought Leeds has us at arm's length. A lot of huff and puff from town, but just as Josh sort of touched on earlier, lacks that real killer instinct and a little bit of quality in front of goal to open us up.
Yeah, I think that's really what it was, wasn't it? I think it were workmanlike from town. I think we tried hard. I think it was just that final third, that little bit of quality. Any other day, we get three or four goals in that game. I think coming out, it's like we said earlier, Dan, didn't we? It was just one of them where I wasn't really downhearted. I hate losing to them like we all do, but if that's the second first best team in the league, it didn't really show it on that performance, to be honest. And I think we were just one of them where we were just a little bit unlucky, to be fair. Any other day, it could have been a different result. It was just two really good goals that won them game, and that's how football goes, isn't it, really?
Yeah, it was a bit of a strange derby for me. It was one of those that you were coming into it, and yeah, we were playing Leeds, but it felt like we could have been playing anybody on that particular day.
No one expected anything, did we? I don't think you were one of them. A free hit, wasn't it?
Yeah, as long as you don't want to get hammered, obviously 5 or 6 nil, but yeah, we lost, and you come out, and actually you came out feeling a little bit positive in the players that actually stepped in for 45 minutes at least, you know. Did a decent job.
Yeah, absolutely. I tend to disagree that we deserved a point. I think Leeds, the annoying thing about Leeds for me at the moment is that I like the manager. I think he's a sound fella with a lot of interesting ideas. His teams play a brand of football which I like watching, so it's really gutting at the moment. But I just think I was pleased with the effort. I was pleased with how we overcame a lot of obstacles before that game. Don't think anybody was expecting us to go out there and beat probably the best side in the league, maybe West Brom. But they are a high-quality team who will go up this year. And we just ran out of steam. We should have taken chances, but their defensive record is so good, and that's not by accident.
And I'm not a big believer in XG. I think, you know, anything that's open to an opinion by someone punching a button, I'm not 100% with. But the XG that we had for that game, I think, was 0.97, according to an article I saw, which is the highest Leeds have conceded this season in terms of expected goals. So it shows that we were doing something right on the pitch. The effort was there. The application was great. Sometimes the quality maybe not. But if you're missing so many players, then that's obviously going to happen. But what did you think of the starting lineup, Martin? We went kind of switched up and went 4-4-2 with Mounier and Grant, big man, little man, defensive mid, a bit of a throwback to sort of 1980s, 90s football, wasn't it, if you like?
It's just an indication that you've got two clubs there who are in different levels, of development. I mean, we're at completely stage one with all the attendant problems that we've had over the last few weeks. And I think what the Cowleys tend to be able to do, which even with Wagner I used to doubt, was that they can overcome those problems and make light of them and make the best of them. Even last night, I know we'll go on to last night, but they did the same last night, made light of problems and a positive outcome. The Leeds game for me was a positive outcome because I think we were showing signs of what type of managers they are going to be, mm-hmm. what type of sides that they're going to put out, what type of characters they're going to have in the team. So I was far from despondent after that game. I knew we were going to lose, and I was happy with the way that we lost.
I concur with that, Dan, Josh. I live in Leeds. I've got two Leeds supporting neighbours. They're both not that bad, to be fair. One of them can be a bit annoying sometimes, but generally they're...
As a Leeds fan, isn't
it? Yeah, standard, but generally, yeah. Generally they're both good. You know, they're good people, and when it comes to football, they're both pretty good for Leeds fans. So you obviously don't want to lose a local derby, and it feels a bit defeatist, if you like, to say that I know what Martin's saying, and I agree fully with what Martin's saying, in that we've kind of come out of that. We've lost a derby, but we've not come off it too badly in many ways. And I think that's exactly what Martin's trying to say. You guys obviously know people who support Leeds. The last thing you want to do is to go into work on Monday, isn't it, and just have to put up with them sort of blah, 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 and what have you. But to be fair, the performance we put in left you feeling, you know, you left the ground.
Yeah, I mean, I came out of it, like I said, okay. Earlier on. Yeah, I felt okay with that. I mean, I saw a lad at work who is a Leeds fan. He sort of first thing sort of Monday morning, and he came up to me and was very much like, to be fair, out of the games he's seen this season, with a team that's caused him the most problems. We opened, it was one, like I said, probably the best defence in the league. We've opened it up on numerous occasions, and he was just honest and said, look, yeah, it were just, it were two good goals that won the game, but on any other given day, it could have gone the other way. It's just how it goes, isn't it? And they're on that, riding the crest of a wave at the moment. Is it seven wins in a row? It's very much like when we went up, they're getting the rub of the green out of the winning games when maybe they're not playing well. And it's a sign of a team that goes up, as much as we don't want to say it, but it's one of those. But no, I came out of it quite positive, really. Like you say, with the team we put out, with what we've got available, as Martin said, with what we've got going on at the club at the moment, what more can you ask apart from going out on the pitch and putting on, you know what I mean, and giving it all and having a go at them? And I think it's a lot better. I think a lot of people expect us to roll over, and we didn't. And that's the probably positive that I can take out of it.
So yeah. Dan, I'll throw a different question at you, because one thing I'd thought of and Martin mentioned there is that Leeds United have this path that they're on. We've obviously got the new management team. There's going to be an overhaul of players. You know that some are going to leave, some are going to come in. A lot of those players, Leeds, Luke Ayling, Stuart Dallas, Calvin Phillips didn't play, but you know they've got several players. Berardi, they've got several players there who've been at the club for 3, 4, 5 years. So they're already way down a path of knowing how to play together, you know, the connectivity, the synchronization, if you like. Does seeing them in a way, and I don't really want to use them as a benchmark to a degree, because in my opinion, they've been better teams in the league, but for, you know, they've got an exceptional manager like Martin says, but does it kind of give you belief that maybe we're on the right path? Because what we're trying to do is similar in a way in terms of building, getting players together, trying to get players sort of thinking together and getting the most out of players. Because Leeds, you look at Leeds, you take Marcelo Bielsa away, and I think Leeds' squad is probably 6th to 8th. I think, yeah. Marcelo Bielsa adds real star quality, yeah, and gets so much out of them, gets an extra 20-30% out of them. He's exceptional at this level. And Danny and Nicky Cowley have started really well. So we're expecting them to get more out of what we've got. I think that's the plan. Do you think that it's a good benchmark to watch and a good advert for getting groups of players together, maybe in smaller numbers, and really sort of sticking with them and driving a philosophy through?
Yeah, I think I put a tweet out after the match from my own personal Twitter, just sort of saying, you know, summing up what I felt about the game. It was a spirited performance from town. Leeds looked solid. They had, you know, 1-11. Each player knew what they had to do. It took me back to when we used to watch Town under Wagner. You know, yeah, they weren't all, sometimes they were Brighton at home, Norwich away, they were phenomenal. A lot of times it were an industrial sort of performance with small patches of 5-minute brilliances. I mean, Leeds score a lot of counter-attacking goals. I mean, I know the fans like to class it as this Bielsa ball, like,
it's actually not that different to Wagner's style.
It's basically counter-attacking football, which has been played for years, but obviously Leeds have been that bad. They see it as some new, newfound way of playing, which, you know, fair play to them. But yeah, I think as a benchmark for where we are now to get to within the next 12, 18 months, if we can get to that sort of level of performance, continuity with squad. I know Leeds don't rotate a lot of players that often, so obviously they've got that working together. I think if we look at them and if we're where they are in 18 months, you know, be quite happy with that. I think both Cowley brothers have got that in them. You talked about the 4-4-2. Formation that obviously looked at Leeds. I've not seen Leeds play at all. This was the first time I've seen them play this season when they played us, despite what they might think about us, you know, paying more interest in them than we do us. But genuinely, I've not seen them this season apart from odd highlights on Quest. But the press, from what I know, the press well, and Cowley set up to sort of almost take away that style of play, but like you said, the big man, yeah, little man, went a little bit more direct.
Went over the top of the
midfield, which, you know, shows ingenuity. We've mixed his formation up, we've played different players, and I think the Cowleys are really adaptable to different situations. I think, as Martin said, under Wagner, we seem to be very one-dimensional. It was the 4-2-3-1, yeah, and it was 4-3-2-1, regardless who was playing, against.
Plan B is to do plan A better, that kind of thing.
Yeah. I think that's the thing, like you said, isn't it, that he's had everything that's gone on, like Martin said, week before that, players not wanting to play, everything like, he's put a team out there, as Danny Cowley said himself, he's changed the formation, this player's playing out of position, there's young lads come back in, and to put a half-decent performance in like they put in, I don't think we can really turn around and say anything. It's one of them, like you say, we've all come away and we've all sat around the table here and said, yeah,
you'd be hard pressed to find a Town fan who came out of that ground really angry. You know, you can be disappointed, but you can take positives out of defeat. I know people everyone's positive all the time, and you know, all right, fair enough. You know, there were some players that Mounier, for example, he put a shift in, but it went about 15, 20 minutes, and then he tried to do too much almost. You know, some of them tried to do a bit too much for me.
Just didn't look match fit to me, Mounier. A couple of them kind of, I think Mounier is one of those, I was saying to Josh beforehand, I think Mounier is one of those players who needs like a run of four, five, six, seven games in a row, because he kind of like slowly builds up match fitness, and then you take him out for a couple of weeks and all of a sudden he comes back in looking heavy and rusty. And, you know, the guy takes his shirt off and he's absolutely built. You know, he's not fat at all, but he's kind of like heavy. And I was saying to Josh as well,
he's a big lad, anyway. Is he 6'2"? He must be 16 stone.
Yeah, absolutely.
He's a big fella.
The problem with that is, unfortunately, you have to then watch him for four or five games while he gets up to speed. I mean, his control of the ball on Saturday at times was woeful. For a man who we paid that amount of money for, and unfortunately, it was pretty much the same last night as well. And I don't think the Cowleys have actually started yet. I think they are making do and mending with what they've inherited. And we're going to have to wait probably until August next year before we see fully what they can achieve. But all the basics are there. The values that they have with the players that they select. I think the Bristol City game was a watershed moment for them. Now, that might be a public watershed moment, and the private ones have been before that, but that first half at Bristol was appalling.
Straw that broke the camel's back, wasn't it, I think.
Absolutely. And that's when he effectively came out in public to say what everybody really knew about some of these players.
I like that from a manager, though. I think there's nothing wrong with that at all. You know, you talk about keeping things behind closed doors, but I'm sorry, you know, we have 20,000 fans that go down and pay the money. Like you've just said, everybody knows about these players. You can see it, they're not bothered.
Yeah.
So come out and say, look, I've noticed they're not bothered, and basically, they'll never play for this club again. You know, let's get to January, let's ship them out, let's get whatever we can. I think if we owe X on whatever player, forget about what we've gone, you know, forget about what we've paid before, recoup what we owe, so we're not having to pay more. I'm presuming some of them are on 20, 30 grand a week. We'll save that, you know, and then we have a look. And if we can bring someone in January, bring them in. If not, let's just get to end of this season. Get to end of this season. Moyle probably, you know, be on his way. You're looking at maybe 20 million there. If you can recoup,
I think 15, half that, you'll be lucky, yeah.
Well, whatever we get, it's got to be reinvested, hasn't it? Yeah. Martin's just touched on it. They've not started the, you know, they're trying to build an house with sand bricks at the minute. They need some proper bricks, you know. And I think if Hodgkinson, you know, puts his money in over the summer, you know, I think personally we probably need to spend 20 million. I'm not saying, you know, 5-6 million on each player, but I think we need at least 10.
We just need clever recruitment, don't we? We just need some clever recruitment again, like we did to get us up.
I think what we've learned, Josh, is that, just going on that, Dan, is money doesn't always factor in quality. You've seen Mounier 11 million, Callum Grant 1.5. So I think it's about doing it. I know Huddersfield have peddled this for years about doing it cleverly, you know, and we've tried to be a bit too clever, I think, over the last couple of years. And it's a perfect moment that Martin's moved on to the next point, which is the players that were ostracised, if you like, by Danny Cowley. And he's publicly named. And this was in the preview for Charlton, I think, where he's named Reece Brown. Reece Brown has got a history of being a bad trainer at Birmingham. I'm not saying that that's what it is now, but we can see that that was the history there, and we've gone out and signed him. Everything apparently there was a changed man at Forest Green Rovers, but I guess you can be a changed man when you're getting in the team every week and doing bits and bats. And the real hard work starts when you're not in that team, and Reece Brown's found himself outside of it, and he's now on the transfer list. So, you know, you put two and two together and you're probably not too far away on that one. Herbert Bockhorn signed by Jan Ziever. David Wagner had a number of generals. He signed Chris Lerver, Schindler, Heffley. They were all Wagner men. And I think Jan's tried to go to Dortmund B, if you like, and get one of his own men. And he looks very short of this level, I'm afraid. So
Did Cowley say he wouldn't have picked him for Lincoln, which I think...
Not,
did he actually say those words? I've seen it.
Not publicly.
Without,
it's not a public thing. So if he's told that to someone privately, We couldn't quote it from anywhere, but
Did he play against Lincoln?
He did.
Yeah. That's probably why, then, isn't it?
And the other man that he hung out, if you like, was £13.5 million of Isaac Mbenza, which is a painful amount. And, you know, we're not going to recoup that. And you can add him to Terence Kongolo and Diakabi, who seem to be hung out a little bit from the previous week. And it's all of a sudden three windows, which Phil Hodgkins has said in the summer, starts to look a little bit like it may take longer. Because let's not forget, if I'm a football manager, I want people who are on form, decent. And a point I made to Neil last week, and Neil quite rightly said that people will always take chances on people if the money's right. But people have now got to come in for these guys that we've hung out as having a bad attitude, a bad trainer, and they're not in a team. Currently, I think we're about 19th in the Championship. Terence Kongolo, we paid £17 million for. He's not, you know, he's
I've got to say,
it's difficult to shift them. Is my point?
I know that these lads get a lot of stick, and probably quite rightly. But you're taking a couple of young. Let's take Diakabi for example. You take Diakabi from the south of France at 18 years old, and stick him in the Pennine Hills in the middle of winter. It's now you've got to be something special to come from that area.
It's a culture shock,
and
isn't it?
Overcome those culture shocks. And fit in, and play football, and be a good professional. That comes down to recruitment, and if the character hasn't been sorted out properly, then I have a lot of sympathy with him.
Do you think that's due to being badly advised from agents who are just in it for the money? You know, if you go there, I get.
I think you should be aware of an agent.
As a football club,
you should always be aware of that an agent's. All about the money, isn't it?
As you say, it's a ridiculous change in circumstances for a young lad.
Yeah. Ultimately, it's the club's responsibility to pick the right people. And those people are going to show their colours at some point. Well, I mean, Kongolo, again, we spend, £18 million on him. We obviously, to attract him, must have given him not only money, but some sort of assurances about the club's future.
Let's remember as well.
And then he enters that season.
If they play for Monaco, it's tax-free as well. So the wages are obviously, to match that, the wages are going to have to be. I'm not saying I know how much he's on, because I don't, but the wages are going to be.
You'd imagine he'd be 30 plus or someone at least, even taking into account
the deduction.
A deduction for they said 25%-ish for being relegated.
40-50.
We just went a long way away from what had made us so successful, didn't we? And I think that's come back to bite us, really. We're going from as German players and going down that model and that sort of player to, like Martin said, bringing over like your young French lads and stuff like that, and Benz of Belgium. It's a big shift in what we were used to, and it's just come. We spent a lot of money on players who, essentially, we've been bitten by what happens in the Premier League, haven't we?
Yeah.
When you're a smaller club, you've got to buy these players, you've got to pay over inflated money to get them here, and then they don't want to play if you get relegated, and that's what it is.
It reminds me of... sorry, Matt, you look like you're going to chip in there.
No, keep going.
It reminds me very much like our friends down the road at Bradford. The first season, you know, they stayed up, and then it were all of a sudden, it's like, wow, look at all this money we've got, and they went out and they bought
Benito Carboni, killed them off.
Ridiculous players for ridiculous amounts.
Probably still paying him off, I think.
And the second season, the second season, they did basically what we did, and they got nowhere. I think the biggest problem that we had were we stayed up, and then behind the scenes, it were almost like...
We forgot who we were, didn't we?
What do we do? What do we do now? And it were like... I've used this sort of analogy before when we've chatted about it. We're like almost like the guy who runs the corner shop in your village, all of a sudden being given the keys to it as the superstar.
Yeah.
And he were like, I've got a budget now that's massive. And, you know, we just got a bit excited and we started paying ridiculous, like you say, Kongolo, like 17, 18 million. Huddersfield Town spending that much money on a defender, on a left back. It were unheard of, you know.
Before Wagner.
Ridiculous.
Before Wagner, we had a turnover of something like 12 million.
Yeah,
and now we're paying £18 million for one player.
It's absolutely
and
ridiculous.
you just lose the sense of what it is that this club's about, because I think the support, if they'd have recruited hard-working players within a system that Wagner had introduced and they had gone down, nobody would have been either surprised or particularly bothered about it. I think it was the manner in which we didn't really fight that hard to stay up.
I think you get caught as well, don't you, when you get in the Premier League. It's one of them of, you've got all this money. In order to progress, you need to spend money to do it. You look at Bournemouth. I know they're a multi-billionaire Russian owner or whatever, but they're sort of three or four players a season. They spend good money on it just to enhance the team, and you've got to do it that way. So you do have to change as a club, but then that comes down, like Martin says, it's your recruitment. It's who you're looking at to bring people, and it's doing your due diligence on people. And we've clearly not done it. And that's, like you say, that's why we're in this position.
So I'll bring it back to point. Sorry, Martin. Alistair Wynn's the first one to tweet in, and he says, as expected, it sounds like quite a few will be on their way in January. Are you surprised about any of them? Maybe Reece Brown, for example. But just to move it on as well, Martin, if you're surprised by any of that names that have popped up, should we now, we've learnt an probably learnt an expensive lesson, and you know, poor Phil Hodgkinson's got to pick it up, if you like. Should we now, has this been a lesson to stick with what you know for you?
Yeah, absolutely. I think Town have a significant recruitment problem when they're in the Premier League anyway, because they've got to attract players who will accept relegation clauses. They've got to accept players who are going to come to Huddersfield, which is a great place as far as I'm concerned, but
it's not London,
Manchester. Well, I think some of them stay there. Yeah. And under Wagner, we had a team which was better than the sum of its parts. And the exact opposite happened later. Yeah. And once you lose that, you will throw loads of good money after bad. And that's what they've done, unfortunately.
I think a lot of that, though, as well, it comes back to who we had in charge. You know, Jan Siever. I don't know how you guys feel about Jan, but to me, he just had no control over basically anything that was going on. And I can imagine that a few of these players got together and sort of overthrew him, if you will, with Wagner. We probably had that almost a father-son relationship.
Yeah, I think Billing came out, didn't he, early doors when it were all going on and said that...
After a week, wasn't it?
We're after who's a week this, or so, saying it was this guy coming here like he'd won Champions League or something. So, something wasn't right, were it? I think we went down that Dortmund route. It worked once, it'll work again. But
that goes back to behind the scenes again. It's not only the players that came in that were wrong; it were the manager as well. And
I think they did go down that route, but I think the thinking behind that route was set at a completely different time to when they made the decision.
Yeah.
It would have been rational when they were doing well. It was completely irrational to try and clone Wagner, who by that time was a shell of a man, it looked like to me. You know, when he was completely beaten by all the circumstances that had happened around him. And you try and clone him. I just could not understand
it. From what it looked like to me, it looked like that we'd put all our eggs in the Wagner basket and we hadn't done any proper succession planning. And the last time we did some succession planning was when Wagner potentially was going to go to Wolfsburg or Villa. When we're in the Championship, and it was at that point Jan Siever and Daniel Farke were identified, and obviously Daniel Farke's at Norwich, so the next in line, Jan Siever. So it just felt like maybe we'd gone back to an old Stuart Webber plan, but we've covered that before on previous podcasts. But let's talk about something happy. Let's talk about last night.
Having nodded away, Schindler has also found Bakuna, who brings in Danny Simpson. Injury time at the Valley. Can Town penetrate? Simpson gets a poor pass back from the defence and quickly finds Harajanai. Harajanai's cross. Martinelli shot. Goal, Huddersfield Town! Goal, Huddersfield Town! Young Martinelli has broken the deadlock at injury time. It's Charlton 0, Huddersfield Town 1. And Martinelli will never forget this moment.
700 Huddersfield fans, brilliant turnout on a midweek to it's not even North London, which is easier to get to. It's South East London, which
it's
is not easy.
Quite tricky to get to. Yeah.
Well, the team didn't even make it, did they?
No, it's
a day before. Yeah, but, you know.
On a Tuesday night, when most of our fans live in the North, it's a difficult, and you got to give a lot of respect to people that have travelled down. That's a brilliant trip for them, and they've got a last minute winner there. And Martin, you were there. It's not the best game, but. Does it matter when you score in the last minute that?
It's not in the slightest. I mean, it was chucking down. The weather was absolutely appalling. The ground was a third full, perhaps. I mean, I think Charlton fans have got their own reasons for not being there. And it's not just the form of the club, it's the ownership, etc. But no, it was hugely disappointing as a game. Charlton were dreadful. I know we're going to come on to him. Lee Boyer. Anyway, we'll come on to him. And Town weren't much better, but when Town got the ball, they tended to look as if they might do something. And Charlton just kept giving them opportunities to do it with poor clearances. And Charlton were terrible. We were one step above terrible. And everything was forgiven anyway on 90 plus 2 minutes, because there's no better feeling. And for it to be the young lad to do it as well. And I would say Hadi Janai, who had a good game last night, setting him up. It was, I think Flo might be getting a bit of a renaissance. You never know.
Let's not get excited.
Flo's had some
stick, left back, didn't it?
Broken clocks right twice a day, you know, come on.
To be fair, Flo's had some stick on this podcast, and it's only right to, you know, when a player plays poorly, you'll call him out. When he plays well, you've also got to balance that and say, look, he's played well.
Yeah, I must admit, I didn't see it last night, so that's more of a jest comment than anything else.
The last two comments, the last two games, sorry, Hadi Janai's had a decent game. Against Leeds, I thought he did quite well as well. I thought he maybe should have stretched a bit more for their second goal, but, you know, there's not many defenders are going to get to that. So fair play to Hadi Janai, who did set up the goal. It was a good pullback. He got forward. And the best thing that he did, which probably wasn't, you know, on any highlights, is he made a block, didn't he, Martin, which he threw himself in front of, which was such an excellent bit of defending.
It was just a few minutes before the goal, I think. It was right towards the end.
Yeah.
I mean, by that time, my brain was a bit mashed by what I'd seen in front of me. So maybe my timings are out, but
it was late second half.
Block.
Yeah, he threw his whole body at it and took a stinger, so, you know. It's only right that, you know, as someone here, me, who's given Flo plenty of stick over the last 2 years, hasn't liked him, you've got to say, well done, Flo, great game last night, and hopefully. Yeah. And you know, all you want to see is players play well, perform well, and he's done that, so hopefully we'll see more of the same coming up as well. But one player, Josh, I thought played well and shares your first name, funnily enough, is Josh Caroma. I thought he had a decent second half. I thought he looked lively coming in from the left.
Yeah, I think he grew into it a little bit, didn't he? Mm. I think... one of them is just experience, and he's playing a few levels up from what he's been used to, and I think he's just getting used to speed at game, really. But I think as the game grew on, like, we were cutting in, wanting from left quite a bit. Had a decent chance at a well saved by the keeper. I thought the second half against Leeds, I thought he had a really good game against Leeds. Mm-hmm. And like I say, I think he's sort of taken that. I think if Grant plays him in the first half, he's got a chance on goal. It's nice to see, isn't it? It's nice to see that one of us sort of summer signings that we've got sort of now coming into the team and at least doing a little bit, and only, what, 21?
Yeah. So the recruitment team get panned, don't they, for what's gone on? But, do you know, when something happens like Grant and Caroma, again, you've got to balance it and say, do you know what? Yeah, you got this one right. Well, you know,
it's just well been kick on. Like I said, Cowley's obviously seen something for him. Like, it's taken a while to get in the team, but it's one of them. If you've seen it in him and he can get out of him, he speaks highly of him, see him in sort of press conference and things like that, says that he's willing to learn, willing to... defensive side of his game and all this sort of thing. So long may it continue, really. So we can see a bit out of him.
I think those sort of players are what Cowley's will look to bring in. I know we talked about who they're potentially going to bring in over the next, you know, couple of transfer windows. But you can see that, you know, from videos that go out now, you see a lot more sort of behind the scenes what happens at training and stuff. And you can tell that he used to be a teacher, because he gets the best out of players. He looks at that player and
it's not one size fits all.
This guy, if I put my arm around him, he'll do this. This guy needs a rollicking every now and again. And he kind of...
His man management.
Yeah. And I think that's what we had under Wagner. And I think that's why the togetherness came. And I think once we get rid of the bad eggs, even if we just stayed with what we've got, regardless of bringing anybody in, the togetherness will be a lot stronger. You know, I'm sure we've all worked in teams at work where, you know, everyone's trying to pull together, that there's just maybe two or three that can't be bothered. And all of a sudden, everybody then, you know, it's a lot easier to bring people down to your level than it is to sort of...
We showed last night with goal, didn't it? Like, celebration at goal. You've got Grabara running full length of pitch to celebrate. Yeah. I know it's a 92nd minute winner, but it shows a bit of togetherness. It showed a group of lads there that looks like he's part on the pitch who want to be there.
Well, he didn't have to do that, did he?
And that's what we all want to see. We want to see lads just fighting for the shirt and giving it all, and we can't ask for much more.
It's interesting with Caroma that at Bristol, he replaced one of the lads you were talking about, Dyer Carby, who was subbed after coming on a sub.
Says it all.
And
bad news. That
in that second half against Bristol, although it wasn't great, there were a lot. It was a lot better, and there was a lot more fighting spirit. And he made the difference. He was battling away. He was taking players on. He wasn't accepting being defeated, even though they were 5-1 down within a few minutes of the second half. And I was impressed with him then. I was impressed with him last night, particularly in the second half. And I think he's got a lot going for him.
So, pause. I agree. So, pause. If I said to you, we've set up 4-4-2, I'm going to take off the left winger, Caroma, who's had a good game. I'm going to bring on Danny Simpson and play him at left back and push Flo up into midfield. And I'm going to take Steve Mounier off and bring a midfielder on in Matty Daly. You would think maybe that we've shut up shop a bit.
I'd say, how many of them sort of pints have you had?
But Danny Cowley's shown how far advanced he is of me in terms of tactics, because I sat there and I think I might even messaged you on WhatsApp, Josh, and went, looks like we've shut up shop a little bit for a point. And, it allowed Charlton to come back into the game. There's a bit of a contentious decision that went in our favour for once. We've had four or five games where, Leeds game I'm not counting, but before that, there were four or five games where things went against us quite badly in terms of refereeing decisions. But yeah. I think we might have stolen one there, looking at the highlights. Although,
it was a strange
decision.
The linesman had his flag up early. It wasn't for when it came off the defender. I think you're talking about it coming off the defender.
It's when Taylor scored. I can't tell what he's given. Yeah.
He put his flag up very early, and it was for somebody. I think it was for somebody intervening. Now, it was the other end of the pitch through pouring rain. So, but I did notice the linesman flag going up early. So they made that decision very quickly, and when they make it quickly, I think they're usually right.
Yeah.
Linesmen never get it wrong, so you know.
Yeah, I'll accept that, because it means we haven't had the look that I thought. So maybe we're due a bit more. So hopefully.
And that was the only time that I felt uncomfortable at all.
Lyle Taylor
came on, and it lifted them for 5 or 10 minutes, and then it sunk down again.
Mm. It'd look good in our side, I think. Lyle Taylor.
Absolutely. I mean, compared to what we had up front.
Both of them didn't have the best of games, but one's got more credit in the bank than the other so far this season.
And Grant did have one excellent effort that was saved by the keeper.
Yeah.
But for the rest of the game, I don't know whether the booing got to him, but he couldn't do a thing right.
Mm. Yeah, and some of the messages he got weren't great on social media, but we'll gloss over those, because there are all sorts of types, aren't they? But yeah, pause. We got the 92nd minute winner. Games, you know, Cozzy and Simon, who are regulars on the pod, were both at the game, both down there. And 92nd minute winners are what the game's all about, isn't it? It's one of those where it doesn't matter what happens for 91 minutes, 59 seconds, that ball goes in 92nd minute, it's a brilliant game, and you've had a great night.
You have, and, you know, another, you know, second half of the season of them. I'm sure everyone around this table and everyone in, you know, spots of the field time will be quite happy with that. You know, you don't mind playing poorly. At the end of the day, you go to watch football to win, first and foremost, or I personally do. I don't know about you guys, but I support Huddersfield Town because I support Huddersfield Town. I don't think, I tell you what, I go watch Town on a Saturday because they play some brilliant football. I go because I want them to win. And if they win and play well, it's a bonus. If they play poorly and get a 90-second winner, I'm dancing out of the stadium. You know, it's that's what it's about. We've won, so I don't care. You know,
people don't go for the aesthetics.
No, you don't. No, people seem to think now there's a lot more.
Don't get many wins either, do we? To be honest. So.
But people like look at your Man Cities, your Liverpools, and you know they kind of expect that now throughout football, and it's ridiculous. It's not going to happen. Not every week, anyway. You might have a few good games where you can win and play well, but at the end of the day, it's all about winning. I mean, you spoke about the change in personnel and, you know, who came on and that, but I've noticed sort of Cowley's over the time that they've been here, it's a bit of game management sometimes, I feel. They did it when they first came on with that little bit of run where we went 7 unbeaten, and a couple of them games, you get into, you know, 60, 70 minutes and it's quite tight, and then Huddersfield Town of old, you think, you know, we make a change, we'll sit back, we'll get to 80, we'll get to 85, we'll get to 87, then all of a sudden we've lost. Under Cowley's, 75 onwards, we almost...
I think Brent,
you know,
Brentford,
it's almost like, let's see what they've got for 60, 70 minutes and then let,
Brentford,
let's go for
Brentford away were a big one for that, I think. Yeah. I think you may have touched on that. Yeah, like Brentford away, sort of 60, 70 minutes. It one of them where stay in the game, 1-0 up, saw the game out. And like you say, I think it's...
I think Stoke as well.
Stoke another one, wasn't it? Yeah.
Wagner used to do it. I mean, Wagner... You never felt with the Wagner side in the last 15 minutes that we were going to collapse. Whereas virtually every Town team I've ever seen in my life, I expected them to collapse. And Warnock used to say about second halves, let them go home happy with a great second half. It didn't really matter how bad you were in the first half. If you win and you've had a good second half, they'll forget the first half.
Yeah, well, that brings us back to style of football. I mean, under Warnock, I were only young. But I don't seem to remember much.
Not that
pretty football. Younger than you.
Oh, it definitely wasn't pretty.
But we got promoted. So when you look back at that season, if someone said, "Was that a good season?" you'd say, "Yeah." Why? Because we got promoted.
The football wasn't great to watch if you like watching pretty football. Yeah. But you had great characters. Mm. Jepson and Bulley and all 11 of them. You knew were Warnock players. Yeah.
As a fan, you felt like one of them as well, didn't you? That was one of the great things about that Warnock team is you felt like you were there with them because they took you on a journey, didn't they? And the Wagner era did the same thing. Wagner had a brilliant way of taking you on a journey. And to be honest, I see a lot of ways that Danny Cowley does the same thing as well. And this is why I'm really looking forward to what he can bring to us because I think we were onto it. You know, if we play the cards right, I think we're onto a really good thing with the Cowley brothers.
Hi, I'm Dean Hoyle, and you're entering the Danger Zone.
Right, guys, welcome to your very first Danger Zone. This usually is headed up by Pozza's mate, my mate as well, and Josh's mate. Sorry, Neil.
You don't like him, though.
I love Neil. Neil's my mate. But yeah, so Neil, I was just thinking because he was your best man
he
was at the wedding.
Yeah.
So this falls on you then, Dan, as the groom to Neil's best man. I think for those that don't know, I think you should tell everybody what Neil actually did to you for your stag do.
Yeah, not my finest hour. When we went off to Manchester, as you do, probably 25, 30 of us, met in Wetherspoons in Cleckheaton. You know, you kind of go down expecting something to be happening on your stag do. Neil actually came up to my house before with a suitcase, shall we say, with a couple of outfits in there, the first one being a full Bradford City kit. And his words were, "Put that on, or you're not leaving this house." And for those of you who know Neil, he's not a small guy, so no, you listen to him.
He's a good 6'4", isn't he?
The brilliant thing about that day the day was brilliant anyway, that I can remember. But we actually went into a pub, and I can't remember who Bradford City were playing, but they were over that way. I think the train had to go through Manchester. It's the pub near Selfridges. Is it the Oyster? The black and white one. Anyway, down there.
Do
you know where
I'm at? Yeah.
And we'd been in a pub just round corner, so we walked in and stood at the bar with the actual City gent, Lenny. I walked in and with bowler out on at Bradford City kit, and he's cheering and all that, and then everyone told him that we're a Town fan. Caused much hilarity throughout the day, did that. So, yeah. Cheers for that, Neil.
You must have looked a bit like Stuart McCall.
I did, yeah, with ginger hair, mate. Yeah, it's not
it's a colour clash with a kick, your face and hair.
And to be fair, I probably had that much hair, I would have fallen off a car as well at some point. So
Poz, you're in the danger zone as well as Lee Bowyer. So Lee Bowyer, so some quotes from Lee Bowyer last night. So as we've already discussed, not the best game, pretty poor. But Lee Bowyer says, "We didn't get anything that we deserved from the game today. I thought my players gave absolutely everything. They're crawling off the pitch. It's difficult to take again. We score a goal that gets disallowed for offside. He's not offside. I don't know what to say. The officials have cost us tonight, and then they go and get one at the end. And I think the main reason why he's in the danger zone is for saying, in the second half, it only looked like one team was going to win it, and that was us. We were on the front foot, and yet we've come away with nothing. Josh, have you ever heard so much twaddle?
I have not. I think Neil had summed it up well by calling him a whopper, wouldn't he? I think that pretty much puts him there, just an idiot.
I mean, it sounds like a typical lead sort of response to that, crying about stuff and moaning about stuff and... You know,
you're a little bit hurt from Saturday, aren't you? I can feel it. You've got a few jabs.
Try not to be, but you know,
you've got a few jabs in now against them.
I don't know what game we're watching, to be honest. I think he's just done that to try and.
I saw you tweeting as well, Martin. You were a little bit surprised by the whopperage from Bowyer.
I was staying in Richmond, which to get from central London to Richmond is like 22 stops on the tube and 45 minutes, and a lot of that is obviously out of signal. And then as we come out and over ground, I looked at my phone, looked at tweeting, and somebody had mentioned Lee Boyer's comments, and I read them, and I was utterly incredulous. I've never, ever heard a manager comment on a game which was so far removed from reality. They didn't create a
single opportunity. They didn't have one shot on target.
They were terrible at the back. And Hogg and Bakuna absolutely ruled midfield. So I don't know what he was looking at.
I don't know who we're trying to say that to, really. I mean, you look at some of the comments from Charlton fans on that sort of them tweets, and it were just...
Yeah, they were spot on.
Exactly the same, pretty much, of what we've just said. What you want about. Well,
I think sometimes it must be quite tough as a manager, because what do you go out and say? Do you go out and lambast everyone and say, yeah, we were absolutely pathetic tonight, and then upset your players, or what? It must be quite difficult in the heat of the moment, you know, to say something sensible. And I think...
Maybe you were a little bit unbalanced because they had the new owner there, or the potential new owners there, who brought Chris Hughton along with them.
Mm. Oof.
So maybe he's thinking, what's going on? I mean, who knows? But
well, maybe he shouldn't have been applying for other jobs then, Lee Boyer, across the football.
Is that a tenner on Chris Hughton to be next Charlton manager tomorrow?
Yeah,
then,
first.
So, on Skybet, thanks
Breaking
for that, Martin.
News, yeah.
So see yourself to the danger zone, Mr. Boyer. Barry Shearman, I will let you in.
Town play down the left and Moyes stayed onside. Here's Meunier. 2-0 Huddersfield Town on the opening day of the Premier League.
What I would like to talk about next is a fellow who's had an opportunity lately. We saw him, he felt so bad for him away at Brentford because he was sat down on the pitch, sad, and the response from Danny Cowley said, I'm happy for the team, but I feel sad for myself. And it was almost a bit, not quite heartbreaking, but it tugged a little bit, didn't it? You think, oh, poor John Goran Stankovic. You know, he's genuinely a very nice guy. And you just felt a little bad for him that he hadn't had an opportunity and that he felt a little bit out of it at Huddersfield. He's now played 4 games in a row at Huddersfield for the first time in his Huddersfield Town career. Thank you, Rob Palmer of Sky, last night for telling me that. And he's looked very good. Last 2 games, he's looked very, very good. And I put a tweet out last night which said along the lines of John Stankovic could save this club a lot of money in the January or summer windows. I'm delighted with how he's played. I think he's got a particular weak point in that physically he could maybe get manhandled by a big striker. But the last 2 games, Martin, Stankovic has been excellent.
Absolutely. I've got to say I've always liked Stankovic. I saw him when we beat Norwich away that December.
Classic.
Stankovic was outstanding. When Wagner's bringing him in and saying, this is the guy I really wanted to sign.
He put him on the same level as Robert Lewandowski at that Millbridge. I think you were there, possibly, at the Millbridge Working Men's Club.
Like, who would you sign? Expected Messi, Ronaldo, basically anyone. And he said, John Goran Stankovic, and everybody in the room were like...
He gave a defender, midfield and forward. I can't remember who the midfielder was, but the forward he gave was Robert...
Midfielder were a lad at Hoffenheim, wasn't it? Midfielder at Hoffenheim, I believe. I can't remember the name now.
It was like a top international player, wasn't he? And Robert Lewandowski. And then John Stankovic. And you're like, and everybody's scrolling to the phone going, who's John Stankovic? But he's just starting to show, Martin, isn't he, what David Wagner was on about Millbridge, in that John Stankovic is such a composed, wiry defender, very clever. And
I think he's shown it before. And I'm absolutely baffled why he's never got into the side after some of the... The only... The bad showing they had was against Wigan that time with Wilshere, was it?
Yeah, Wilshere.
He was absolutely...
Everyone was rubbish that day. Yeah, they were,
but unfortunately, John really did have a bad time with that fella. Although, if I remember rightly, he was also playing on the wrong side. My memory's going, so I don't know. But every time I've seen Stankovic playing, I thought he's looked very classy. Yes, he might have a bit of a strength issue, but he hasn't had a strength issue.
That'll get better with games, though. Yeah. That's the thing. That's Dan, you've played football at centre-back, haven't you? Obviously not to the same level as Stankovic or myself. No, I'm joking. I wasn't that good. But Stankovic, as an outfield player, as a defender, you rely on runs of games to get up to speed, you know, and to kind of find your way in. And when you play two games, don't play for a month. And let's not forget, he was injured with a cruciate ligament knee injury for just about over a year. He's come back, he's had balance issues, strength issues, and we don't really have a proper reserve like back in the day. I know we made a joke of Ponting's league, didn't we, Martin, just before we started. Back in the day, he could have played his way back to some sort of fitness, but you don't really have that now. And point I'm trying to get to very slowly here is that the run of games has really shown what John Stankovic can do, and he's forming a really effective partnership with Christopher Schindler and Josh Chuk, you can jump in as well, but he's started to form this partnership with Schindler where they both can play out from the back really well, and all of a sudden you're watching them ping balls out last night to the midfield, and Josh, you've said if we can sort the three out behind the striker, it could be a start of something quite exciting, really, because those two can both play football from the back, and he's now got that run of games to show what he can do.
Yeah, it's tough. I mean, in any position, it's tough. But I think you look at teams historically throughout football, and you know, you're back four and five with a keeper. If those four are in sync with a decent keeper behind them, you know, that five is all. People talk about strikers, you know, sort of.
The Arsenal 90s team was a good example of that, yeah.
Yeah, you know, strikers win your games, yeah, but your defence win your leagues. And I know I don't like to big them up too much, but as we've talked about, like Leeds, they don't concede many. And if you don't concede many, you've always got a chance. And I think...
Chance of nicking it, haven't you? That's the thing.
Yeah, exactly. And I think Stankovic coming in and getting a run of games. Whenever I've seen him, apart from obviously the Wigan game and stuff like that, he has looked a bit of a footballer as well as a defender. And I think sometimes it's hard to find someone to play next to somebody like that because, you know, you look back and you think, right, we need, again, probably a little bit old school Sunday league style, but your centre half, you know, big lads.
You stopper, stuck in. Big stopper, don't you? Yeah.
And I think that role as a centre half has probably evolved because you don't really have that old school centre forward anymore.
No.
So but your centre forwards evolved, you know, your big 6 foot, you know, bruisers, so you needed someone to go up against that.
They're clever now, aren't they? They're clever and tricky and incisive.
Yeah, now you've almost got... Not all teams, but a lot of teams don't really play wide class as an out and out centre forward, you know, like Liverpool's. They've got like the three, aren't they? A lot
like
of teams
a false
sort of
nine,
play
isn't
that,
sort
yeah,
of thing
all that sort of nonsense.
Yeah, just call it a nine, don't they? And they drop off quite
a
lot. Yeah,
and then your wingers come in and all that sort of stuff. And I think Stankovic has got more of a brain on him than probably centre halves of old would have. He'll get into the right position. I think is it the quote from Maldini, whereas if you have to make a tackle in the wrong position and all that stuff. And half at battle as a centre half is actually if you're in the right position, you're going to do well regardless of who you're playing against. And I think once he gets some more games under his belt, I think he'll be, as you say, Matt, I think he will save us buying a centre-half at £5 million. He's no worse than anybody of that level that I've seen in this league.
I was trying to think of who we could potentially look at. And one of the only ones that I could really think of that might be in our range of player, because we're not going to go take someone from Derby or whatnot. Although if they have FFP issues, you never know. But was the only one I could really think of was Jake Cooper at Millwall, you know, an up-and-coming one. And even then, they probably want £5-7 million for him. And is Stankovic not at his level?
Yeah,
few games more. And, you know, that's what I mean. He could save this club £5-7 million rather than going to get someone like Cooper because Stankovic
that's
is better
the thing,
on
the ball. It's like you said earlier on, he's his fourth consecutive start and it's the most he's made for the club. And like you say, it's one of them where he's always shown flashes in games. He's had games where you've looked at him and thought, that guy's a really good footballer or can be a good footballer. And like we said earlier, he's had injuries. He's not been able to get in the side for various reasons, either people in better form or whatever. But like I say, with Schindler at the moment, they're looking good. They've got your two players there who can play football.
Yeah.
And if that's what you want to play, you need your two centre-halves. That's just how football's gone now. You need to play out from the back. And like you say, you've got a player in Stankovic who's... equally at home, really, in sort of defensive midfield, you could say, as well. He can play there easily enough.
Yeah, the Stanker Man, as I called him last season when he was, yeah.
Stanker-lele.
You have some great nicknames for folk, I tell you. I don't know where you get them from. I like that one, the Stanker Man. Like Anchorman, but Stanker Man, I like
exactly,
it.
That's the point. Yeah.
Every successful town team I've ever seen has always had a sort of iconic pairing of centre-halves.
Cherry and Elliman.
Cherry and Elliman in particular.
Sinnott and Scully.
Roy, I still see virtually every game up and down the steps, is a real town supporter.
Yowds and Yates.
Yes. But
iconic for all the wrong reasons. Then.
But Roy was quite basic. He was a good centre-half, but he was basic. And then
big guy,
Cherry,
wasn't he?
Yeah,
big guy,
and Cherry was class.
He's classy, yeah.
Yeah, very classy player. Hanvey and Sutton, very similar. Sutton were a... Hanvey wasn't a bad player. He was a good player, but he was more the stuck in.
So you've got, like, you've mentioned there with two contrasting styles. You've got your big stopper, like Dan, you said, your big stopper, and then your more cultured one, if
absolutely,
you like. But we've actually got two cultured ones at the moment, haven't we?
I think as Josh rightly says, though, that's almost the way football's gone now, you know. Even look at your top teams like Man City, drops Fernandinho in there, who's actually a centre midfielder, actually...
It's like Barcelona with Mascherano as well.
Well, defenders do they do that much defending? Like the youth, you know,
not for Man City.
Talking usually tackling and body on line, and you very rarely see that anymore. Yeah, if someone makes a tackle like that, it's usually because they've got turned or it's a desperation to block a shot. You know, I can't really think of the last time I saw Bakuna.
Had a Janai last night.
He gets stuck in, but football's almost evolved into blocking and pinching the ball rather than coming through and clattering someone. And, you know,
from Johnny Ogle over the Saturday.
Well, yeah. Do you know what I mean, though? As a centre half, it's very rare that you see that, like a really good, what I'd class as a tussle. It's a lot of blocking and a lot of I'll get it way. And
they're a bit of an outdated relic now, aren't they? Your big butch centre half, you know, your.
I mean, you probably last one were like your John Terry. He's probably what I'd class as like.
It's like you said, it's involved. There's no, can you name a really big, is there any teams in the top Vincent level Kompany football maybe, that play like an out and out centre forward? Really? Do you know what I mean? There's no real.
If they are big, like Van Dijk, they've also got pace and can play as well. And that's why they go to the very top, don't they? But Dave Oracle's tweeted, he says the difference between playing Stankovic could make the back line over the next, the difference he could make over the next few games. Very impressive in the last two games as well. We'll move on from Stankovic a little bit. And one thing that we tweeted out earlier, or I tweeted out, was for our 50th episode, your opinion on Twitter. Who over the last couple of games has come out of the HTAFC EDT, Elite Development Team, or Fringes to really impress you and stake a claim? We've had the love in for Stankovic. The responses we got was Mark Harrison, probably aimed at me and Neil, and it's fair game, I think, says that the Kosovan kid's done okay in the last few games. Like I said, credit where credit's due, he definitely has, so hopefully that continues. Carl and Grant FC, Dominic Lister, at Regminator and Hoods Josh have all given a lot of praise for Josh Caroma as well. All in particular said there is a lot of skill there and highlighted the crosses against Leeds and the shot against Charlton, which you did as well, Josh. And the cross he put in for Kachunga was
a pinpoint, excellent. Wasn't it? He just said put it in net, but unfortunately he didn't.
Just wrong man.
Yeah.
I mean, to be fair, it was a very, very good save, that.
He made himself big, didn't he, the keeper, yeah.
He shouldn't have a chance to save it, though, really, should he?
To be fair, I mean...
He's probably a bit too close, maybe.
I was just going to say, he's probably one of them where...
It's easy to smother, isn't it, from... As a goalkeeper, it's easy. Yeah.
But I think it's one of them as well that probably if it comes off sides of his cheek rather than his forehead, it goes in.
Yeah.
You know, don't get me wrong, he should have scored, and I've said on Twitter. And
It's not as if it's the first time, unfortunately.
And I think that's probably what made it a lot worse. If he hadn't done them gubbers, you know, a couple of weeks earlier, people would probably forgive that.
Kachunga was good last night as well. Really hard work.
He's industrial, isn't he?
We've got a few tweets about Kachunga, so we'll probably talk about him in a minute. But I've thrown open the door to our brilliant... Twitterati, if you like, who get in touch with us on Twitter. So one thing that really makes the podcast is the interaction between Huddersfield fans and us guys. And I tweeted earlier that if we didn't have that interaction and people didn't support what we did, then we probably wouldn't have got to the 50th episode, which is today. It's really well appreciated that we can interact with people without being told that we're full of rubbish, if you like. So so we've had a few, and Lee Morris was one of the first ones that when I've said, what would you, you know, you guys set the agenda. Lee Morris says that new town book must surely get a mention. So I've not done our Those Were the Days feature for a little while. So Lee Morris, coming up to Christmas, Lee Morris has got a book, Where Are They Now? It's actually really good. I'm not just throwing it in there for no reason. It's a decent book. available Waterstones Club Shop. Martin's got it, I think.
I went to his house to buy it.
Did you? Did he sign it as well? I've got a signed copy.
Unfortunately, the value of yours is just slightly
limited edition of two, hopefully. Lee Morris's book is available. It's at Lee_Morris_ if you want to find out more. But it's a really decent book, which will tell you about pretty much every town player you can think of and what they're doing now. We'll definitely be using that for the feature shortly. At Jody Calvert. Jody's one of our brilliant, at Forever Town. She's one of the really good ones who gets in touch on a weekly basis. She says, and I'll aim this to you, Dan. What do you all want from Santa this year? This can be town related or not, if you like.
What do I want from Santa? Can he deliver late in January and bring me some new players? In fact, no, I don't even want any new players. I just want rid of all these idiots that we've got, you know. That'd do me fine as a Christmas present.
So in a stocking to another club is a couple of players for you. Any of you guys, Martin, you must have seen...
I'm too old for Christmas wishes, to be honest.
And Josh, you're the youngest, I think, here. So
bad humbug. Get what I get.
Jody, I think the answer is that we wish it was more sort of Chinese New Year, don't we? So we could get rid of a couple of players and bring a few in. So that would be great from Huddersfield perspective. And Paws, once you've got kids, it's all about them, isn't it?
I think what I get, I think a pair of socks, I'd be quite happy with. Maybe a Toblerone. You've got to get a Toblerone at Christmas.
Do you know what? B&M, I think it is, do a Toblerone. I'll show you a picture.
It's
50 quid.
And 50 quid for 50 a Toblerone?
I've got a picture next to my little boy, Charlie, and he's only little, but geez, you should see the size of this Toblerone in B&M. Martin's seen it. Martin's got one by the looks of it.
I have seen them.
I think the only person that's likely to pay 50 quid for a Toblerone is
a fat knacker like me. Go on, say it.
I was going to say town recruitment team from other summer. You know, they like paying over odds for stuff, don't they?
Angry tweet from Josh for you there. Not this Josh.
Cut that out if you want.
No, I'm not doing any editing. So, at Richard Cosmala, our friend who's currently down in London enjoying Judith Cosmala.
Bloody hell. I love her, isn't he?
Our friend Cozzy, he says the standard of football in the Championship compared to the Premier League. I'm glad we won, but it was a similar quality game to what you see at Guiseley. Cozzy does often go to Guiseley as well, so he's not just saying that. What happened to people just being able to do the basics like pass to a man or control a ball? Or was it always this bad? So this is something I said on the pod as well a few weeks ago. We've come down from the Premier League. We've seen Bernardo Silva, you said, you know, Van Dijk, company, Salah, all these players have come to Huddersfield. Have we become a little bit deluded in terms of the quality of the Championship? And was it always this way? Or do you agree with me and Cozzy in that the Championship and the players in it just seem particularly weak? One potential argument I could have is that financial fair play is maybe finally starting to have a bit of an impact, whereas clubs maybe not spending as much as they would, and maybe players are staying longer at clubs and stagnating a little bit, and that's therefore you get a little bit more lesser quality. But what we were saying earlier,
I go to watch Town, and I go to watch Town win if they can. Quality, it's fine, but
it's okay.
As long as Town win, I'm not really that bothered. And when we were in the Premier League, at first, it was quite interesting because you were seeing top quality players. I mean, one of the things that always sticks in my mind is how few times they let the ball go out of play. Mm. And then in the Championship, like, out all the time. Yeah. And the quality of passing and the movement and all that.
It's faster. They move the ball faster. And it's more the terms of how you play Burnley, you play Crystal Palace, they'll have three chances and they'll score twice. Yeah. We'll have three chances and not score for three games. You know what I mean? They're a lot more clinical. And with that, they can play that sort of defensive, direct style a bit more and be effective.
It can also get antiseptic, can it? I mean,
it's boring. I find the Premier League boring.
Yeah, it is boring.
I do. It's not my favourite league. I love the Championship, but it's...
I don't think it's the strongest Championship there's been in a long time, though. I think you look at it, there's a lot of teams in there that are much and muchness, isn't there? Yeah. And I don't think the quality...
Being one of them,
as we are. I think you just look at it and... I've said to you earlier on, I don't think there's been one team this season that I've looked at and I've thought they're a really good team. I've looked at like West Brom, went in front there twice. There's no been really stood out for me where in other years.
I thought that. And then I watched West Brom against Swansea on
Sunday. Yeah, and they played anyway.
And I was like, on Sunday, actually, I'm wrong. West Brom are a very good side. And I wasn't that impressed with Leeds.
It's weird though, because I think when we went up, it's one of them where you think, oh, yeah, the top level of the Premier League, yeah, it's miles above what you think. But you look at Watford and Burnley, and I remember saying, I think, to our mate Dave, and saying, oh, you know, it's just teams at Championship level can match these teams. But then we've dropped down this season, now looking at it and think, well, now they probably can't. Do you know what I mean?
One thing about the Premier League I find as well is it's relentless, and that the teams at the bottom don't have many days off. And if you don't play at full tilt, you'll get beat. Yeah. Whereas in the Championship, we could turn up and we played Hull. We played well for about 30, 40 minutes in that game, but Hull were useless and they had a complete day off and we beat them 3-0. And we could spin several teams who don't turn up. Charlton last night didn't turn up, beat them 1-0. Stoke didn't turn up, beat them 1-0. A lot of teams don't turn up.
I think that's one of the things that I take away from Premier League, that for Town to get any sort of result against anybody in the Premier League,
let alone your top team,
every player had to be a 10 out of 10. And if one player were an 8 and the rest were 10, that team would find that weakness in that player and it'd be a goal. I think, like you said, the speed of the Premier League is just unbelievable. Just the way that they move the ball, it's ridiculous compared to what we've seen this year. It's like sometimes it's two or three touches to get a ball under control. It's not just Town, it's everybody.
It's everyone, isn't it? Yeah,
you know,
it's
Premier League, it's bang, 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 bang. Look at Liverpool. You know, I mean, all right, yeah, they're probably the best team in the world, as much as it pains me to say, because I don't really like Liverpool.
I'm with you.
But they are. The way that they play football at the minute is phenomenal. And I think the one of the things in general of football is now we are maybe oversaturated with football. You can sit in your front room and you can now watch football in Premier League, you can watch La Liga, you can watch, you know, German football, you can watch top flight football across the world almost.
Even the MLS got you on Sky.
And then fans get used to that. Yeah. You know, they might watch 3-4 games a week of that standard and turn up at Town on Saturday and expect it to be the same. And it's not going to be. It's just not going to be. And I think you've got to kind of take a step back sometimes from what you'd like to see and what you can see and what you're happy at seeing. And like we've said tonight, if we turn up and win, everyone's happy. No one goes home and goes, "Go, bloody hell, we've won today, but that were rubbish." You go home and you boy, yeah, we've but won today. You forget.
Some do apparently, but definitely not here. Right, we'll buzz through some of these we've got through. So at Terrier7N2, Mike says, Josh, if a 20 million plus offer comes in for Carl and Grant in January, should the club take it?
Oh, it's a tough one, isn't it? Nope. It's one of them. You'd like to say no, because you'd like to want to keep him, because he's a goal scorer. It's easy money to take it.
Phil Hodgkinson sometimes listens to this, and he's probably sat there going, it's easy when it's not your money.
You want to keep your best players, don't you? And goal scorers at any level, you need them.
Yeah, I think if we let Grant go in January, that puts us in jeopardy.
Yeah, because you've got to replace him, haven't you?
Yeah,
and that's the thing, isn't it? So you don't want.
I don't think
we'd do it as a club.
What about you, Mike? For me, it's a no. For Josh, it's a no. 20 million is a lot of money for a good player.
Yeah, I haven't been upset by a player being sold or leaving Town since Marcus Stewart. I really
that was a killer. Yeah,
still pains me to this day.
The fact is that if he's good enough to play at a higher level for more money, the likelihood is that he will go. And if he doesn't go, then you've got the dilemma of what's his mind going to be like.
To be player honest, power.
I don't think he will go in January.
He seems switched on to me, does Carlan? He seems quite focused and switched on for us.
He's a great goal scorer.
Seems a good guy as well.
Yeah, but his all-round game needs quite a bit of improvement. And
I think we were talking earlier
about the quality of players in the Premier League. And although he did well for us in a poor team, I don't think he's at that level.
No, yet. He's not.
He might get there, but
I think he's getting there, but I think one thing that people will always say, natural goal scorers are few and far between, so people will always take a gamble, won't they? Yeah. And they will take a gamble.
It'll be a test for us, won't it? It'll be a test if a team comes in and waves that money under us.
I think, to me, yeah, like you say, it's a statement of intent more than anything. Yeah. If we keep him, it shows intentions of building the squad around him.
Yeah.
If we sell him, does that mean that we're then going to spend, if we got 20 million, for example, 5 million here and there to strengthen the squad? You know, to me personally, and
strikers are difficult to replace out for that quality.
Yes, they are.
January,
you know, to me, though, I think I'd hope, Phil, if you're listening, have a conversation with him early. He's in good stock at the minute, is Grant. He's scoring goals in a team that's, you know, down at the bottom. Is it a case of, tell you what, stick with us till end of the season, carry on scoring, all of a sudden we might get an extra couple of million for you. You might get an extra thousand on your wage. So there's pros and cons, isn't there?
Similar to what we did with Jordan
both,
Rhodes.
For both,
Jordan
you know, Rhodes, same with
it depends if he's happy as well, doesn't it? There's always that in there. If he's happy with football, if he's happy with Danny Cowley, he's enjoying his football. That plays a part in
if
it.
If it doesn't rock
as well.
The boat, because we've had enough bad characters, and I'm not saying Callum Grant's the opposite of that from what
I've seen and what I know. I don't think he would.
But we don't want an upset player. Yeah.
It's a bit. I think someone just mentioned it then. Rhodes, I heard it's very similar.
We gave him some money, didn't we?
And in summer, if someone comes in, we can't stand in your way. That's the old Huddersfield Town. And we bring them in, put them in shop window. Sell them and hopefully reinvest wisely across.
And I'm sure everybody are wishing the best of luck if somebody did come in like a Wolves or something and we got a good price for him.
I can't see him going, as Martin says, to a... If he goes to the Premier League, where's he going to go? Is it a Watford?
It would really suit Sheffield United, I think, in that 3-5-2 that they play. Yeah, but whether they have the money to prize him away...
I don't think they're going to be spending 20-odd million.
They did it on Ollie McBurney, but they would...
They've not played him, have they? It would be
a bit of a risk for them, I think.
They won't even perceive that they need to spend that money.
Probably not. They probably don't, to be fair, do they? Because they're like us in our first season, whereby they've kept the nucleus, haven't they? And they're doing...
A bit better than us than
Well, you say that, but I think Sheffield United is going totally off course here. You know, I wouldn't think they were going to stay too far up the league. If you look, they're high up the league, but when the point, when you look at the points...
They're about 4 points off.
All it's two or three injuries and...
It's always precarious.
Let's blast through these. Danny Bell at Danny Bell 32. Do you think it's a good idea to want a smaller squad? Danny Cowley has mentioned 22 players, but we've 28 and are struggling for cover. I know a few are out due to attitude, but a fair few are out injured. Would it not be better to have a similar size squad to now, but with better attitudes? We'll go with you, Martin.
I think attitude. I don't care about the numbers. I think attitude is the whole thing. I think they've got a point that if they have 28, it's difficult to keep everybody happy. But it depends on the makeup of that 28. If you've got 15 who are,
I think this is first team. I think this is 28 first team. So I don't. I wouldn't class the EDT bunch or players like Caroma as that. I think. I like to take, because we've had one majorly successful manager, David Wagner, and he set a lot of blueprints for, you know, what we were doing in the Championship, and he had pretty much two players for one position, and then he would rotate those two players, and it would keep them happy to a degree. So I agree that 22 players is probably right, but that doesn't mean, that doesn't not include players in your EDT squad. So if you do get injuries, then they would come through.
That's the whole point of it.
Jaden Brown has done, like Dehaney's done, you know. So I think 22 first team members is probably right, and I think that's probably, I think with our wage budget, our wage structure, or what our wage structure will be. Going forward, I would imagine 22 is a good number, and you know, I think that's that's a good amount. Josh Phillips, and this is probably one I should avoid for now. Josh says, could Flo still have a future with Town? Drastically improved the last two games and seems to be giving everything. Has something clicked, or is it a false dawn? I'm going to go with you, Poz, because you're my mate as well, and Josh, I think as well. I think we're all, I think it's one big sort of family almost, isn't it? Dale the Danger Marsden, our buddy. Says he reckons he's playing for a transfer, but he's done well last two games. Flo Hadajanai, for me, it doesn't quite erase the last 2 years. But do you think something's changed, and that maybe he's got a long term future, not just a short term?
I think it's a strange one with Flo, because when it all came out, you know, prior to Leeds game, about these, you know, bad apples and players not wanting to play and stuff like that, one of the first players that came into my mind was Flo Hadajanai. Do you know, is he just not very good, or has he just not been trying? Maybe a bit of both.
I think Bristol City, Martin, you went to Bristol City, and there he looked sketchy.
He wasn't one of the worst. Definitely not one of the worst. That was down the left side. But I don't know, Flo. I think he's burnt his boats with the support, and once you've done that, it takes a hell of a lot to get it back. And it's not just one occasion. It's several performances that were just unacceptable. As people rightly say, he's had two good games. He is a good footballer.
Steady.
And perhaps he was out of position. But he's also weak at times.
Championship's a hard league, isn't it? So he physically is built like a breadstick, isn't he?
I mean, I look at the teams that have been put out over the last two games, and as Flo played basically because there's been nobody else.
Yeah, absolutely.
That, that, do you know what I mean? Where, who else would you have played in those positions in the last two games?
I mean, it could be on other sides.
He did try Congolo, didn't he, in that position first, and Terence let us down quite badly at Bristol City, and obviously that was the watershed.
Nice on the other side, though, even if he's playing for a transfer, at least he's putting a shift in. Currently, we all, if just he, from what's going on.
He carries on playing like that on this season to get a move.
Yeah.
If he plays like that, I'm fully supporting of him if he plays like he has done the last two games.
And yeah, if he won't put in a shift in, Carlo wouldn't have picked him, would he? No. You know what I mean? He's obviously training, right? Yeah, he'd have been out the door like the rest of them that aren't being picked. So that for me, if he wants to play for a transfer, but he's actually putting a shift in and giving it all, fair play, doing it the right way.
Josh, do you sit in the south stand?
Yeah.
No? Paul, you definitely do, but Josh, you sit sort of singing section-y, kill the bank, don't you? So Freddie Cocker sent one in, and Freddie, I'm ignoring your first one because that's way too deep for a pub chat. But a top five best individual heckles and chants from town to opposition or town players at games over the years. This is probably a bit of a thinker.
And I think one springs to mind straight away. I think we played Burnley when it were really bad rain. Can't remember what season, maybe, might have even been when we were in Championship. Absolutely hammered it. No, we were at home. I think we were, I think 2-1. I can't even remember. Scott, I just remember a chant. And announcement came over and it were this certain roads flooded. And everyone sort of just erupted into it. We're like 2-1 and you can't get home or something like that. And that, for some reason, had just stuck in my mind, you know, as a good heckler chant. I think some of the heckle chants now are so pathetic, they're not even worth
not heckles, are they?
You know, they're just changing a couple of words from a song that they've just sung to you, and he just goes backwards and forwards for a couple of minutes.
I always think it's ironic, town fans at Fulham singing, what a terrible place Fulham is.
It's always a great one, that, isn't it? Fulham's when you get old fans singing it at our place, it's always a good one, isn't it?
It's like, come on. But I think not to play the age card too much, Martin, but you'll probably remember the famous Roger Miller chant. You'll remember that, where he apparently got very upset. Was he Portsmouth at the time?
Portsmouth.
And I think our friend Polish Hippie started that one to something about his wife, and he apparently got very upset and put him off the game, didn't he? Which
I've liked Vardy's responses to opposition taunting about his wife and over the last few weeks. A lot of time for Vardy. I wish we'd have bought him.
He's put the ball in the net. That's the best response you can get, isn't it?
I like a player that's like Vardy, though. You know, you get a lot of fans who are quite happy to stand in a crowd of X amount of 1,000 people giving someone dog's abuse, yet they score a goal and turn round, and all of a sudden, oh, no, they can't do that. You know, they're professionals.
Yeah, Ross McCormack, when we were singing, Ross McCormack doesn't want to play against Leeds,
and
he scored a hat-trick, and he ran over, rubbed our noses in it. And do you know what?
Fair play to him.
Yeah, exactly.
You've got to take it, haven't you?
Yeah, that's it. The keeper at Norwich did it the other week when they're playing Arsenal, dancing around on his line. And then
Tim Krull.
That's the one. Yeah. Saved the first one, fair enough. And then the second one had been taken and he scored. And Arsenal player said something. And he's up in arms about it. He just spent 10 minutes winding him up. He scored.
I think if you give it, you take it. Yeah.
You know, it's 100%. All banter at the end of the day, isn't it?
100%. I don't think we can think of any more off the top of our head, Freddie, so I'm sorry about that. But Sam, at He Shoots Coca-Cola, how much of a loss are you willing to take on some of the excess players that have no future here? I think that's up to Phil. Like I say, it's easy when it's not your money, isn't it?
Yeah, I know.
But you would obviously want to try and get as much back as possible. But what areas do you feel we need to strengthen? Marcus Madison from Peterborough is my shout. I'm sorry, Sam, but I've been shouting for that for a long time.
Banging on that door for a while, haven't we?
Yeah. Marcus Madison is definitely one player I like a lot. But Premier League loans is the rumour, so to speak.
Probably a sensible approach, to be honest, just to chip in there. I think we don't want to be spending great amounts of money in January. It's just to see us through. And
I think the key is Phil Hodgkinson has said more than once that the value in January isn't what they would like it to be. So I think set your expectations at a low level.
I think he's come out and said a mixture, hasn't he, the other day? I think it's only if the right players are available. I think if we're buying, it's buying for the long term, innit? I don't think it's just to see us through.
But I read somewhere that Marcus Madison's release clause has expired, and Mr. McAntony is now asking for a lot of money. So
I'll double it for us as well.
With him being out of the contract at the end of the season, if that's the case, then wait till the end of the season.
The sort of player you'd want in the side, though, and he's the sort of player looks like he's been too good for League One for a while. Always double figures for goals, assists, right age.
When I was trying to push this, I worked out at the same time I worked this out at the start of the season, when it, I think it was maybe the end of August. that Marcus Madison had been involved in as many goals and assists that had come directly from him as what in the last 3 years as what Town had scored. So I know it's League One to Premier League Championship, but he's involved in a ridiculous
how
amount.
How have time to do all this?
Transfer Max does it all for you. It's brilliant.
It shows you it all.
You just put all seasons. It just lists it.
If I don't even know who this guy is, and you've worked all this out.
If you can add two numbers together, Poz, it's fine. Really? You're all right. Marcus Madison, yeah, he's a cracking player, but I think he'll be quite in demand. I would imagine because he's having another good season. Chris Sandys, at Chris Sandys says, if you could time travel and hear your 100th episode, who's the HTFC player you're talking about with most affection and least affection? And where will Carl and Grant be playing? So 50 episodes is probably another 12 months away, maybe a little bit longer. Carl and Grant won't be at Huddersfield Town is my prediction because I think if he keeps it up, he'll be gone in the summer.
Yeah, I agree.
Lewis O'Brien is someone that I tipped to have a breakout season this year. I think I'll still be going on about how great he is. And I'm going to say that I will be mentioning Scott High as the next potential Huddersfield Town player to really do well, because I think technically he's very, very good, and he's one to watch for me, is Scott High, in 12 months. And hopefully they all come through. That's the dream, isn't it? When Matty Daly scored, you saw... I know the guy who scouted Matty Daly over in for Stockport Schools. He's a mate of mine, and he brought Matty Daly and Ben Jackson to the club. And... you know, he's buzzing. You know, he's a Huddersfield Town fan all his life. And he's so happy, you know, that this kid that he saw at 13, 14 has played and scored the winner for Huddersfield Town. Mm-hmm. And to be honest, there is no better feeling than seeing one. I know Matty Daly's from Stockport area, so he's not quite one of our own. Yeah. But, you know, there's no better feeling than seeing an Alex Smithies come through and doing well. Andy Booth, you know, those sort of Delroy Fitz, you know, those sorts of players. And it gives you a... And you know, John Worthington, I went to the same school as John Worthington and Wycliffe, and, you know, lucky enough to play in the same school team as him once or twice, and
I coach with him now.
Yeah, and then the next minute he's captain of Huddersfield, and that the bond that you feel towards the club strengthens, doesn't it? So it's always fantastic. But Scott High is my shout. Josh, I'll open it to you. You watch a lot of youth games, don't you, and whatnot. So in a year's time, Marcus Madison, are you going to say? Is
I don't know. Maybe Kieran Harrott, something like that. You know, being brought in, being tipped highly.
Kieran Harrott,
a lot of goals.
I say, guys, he's 17 years old and he's built like he's 27. He's Kieran Harrott. He looks like he could. You know, and I know you shouldn't really take too much from youth games and warm-ups, but every time he gets the ball in the warm-up, bang, top corner, bang. He never misses. Bang, top corner, bang, top corner. And he, Josh, I think that's a good one to pick out because he, you know, with the size, you know, the strength, the natural ability, he's definitely one that could, you know, all being well, touch wood, tables wood, he could be a really big player in 12 months. Yeah, good one. Pause. I've caught you off guard there, haven't you? You've got no idea,
mate, to be honest.
Carl and Grant.
Carl and Grant, yeah. No, I like, obviously, like you've mentioned O'Brien before, he's obviously come through, he had a good spell at Bradford, and he's obviously learned a lot sometimes playing in rough and tumble leagues, you know, non-league, I think, at Bradford now. But they can sort of, you know, they can give you a lot of confidence moving forward. That he's only quite a small guy, isn't he? He can ride tackles. He can. So he's right niggly. It reminds me of like Johnny Ogg in a way. He kind of gets his body in way rather than kind of
his first touch. He just moves the ball between his feet. Like
a classy John Worthington.
Yeah, I was thinking, yeah.
Similar.
Ginger, yeah.
Yeah.
Pozzy sat there, stood up now. His fist clenched, march out.
Similar style, but we've missed Lewis, I think.
Yeah, he's a quality player, isn't he?
I think against Leeds, it would have been an asset.
He's one of them players you can put anywhere, isn't he?
Yeah. That's left back, he looked just as effective as, you know, looked a better left back than we've had all season. Yeah, we lost a bit from the field, but
I did feel sorry for the young kid the guy who scored in all the goals. When he came on against Leeds, I don't think he actually touched it, did he? Did he?
A little bit, but...
I probably be sorry for him.
I think that we're a little bit disjointed running to the ground. We've got to take him off more than...
Yeah. I think we're a little bit disjointed, weren't we? I think system-wise.
Well, it wasn't great for him to come on then.
No, it was probably the worst possible time for him to make his debut.
No, I think Kieran Harrott comes from Hemsworth, you know, that. So it's a small, really close community is Hemsworth. So I think when a player comes through like that, they'll all be really delighted for him in Hemsworth, especially the Huddersfield Town fans, you know, my mates, the Kelly family down there, will be really, really happy with what's going on
there.
You
know, it's nice to see that bench against Leeds, to see that
I
many,
loved it, me.
That many I players. That, yeah. Give me a starting 11 of that sort of player, the Nadia Carby, an Mbenza, a Mounier. Do you know what I mean?
Did it remind you of the Jacko days a little bit?
It did, to be fair, yeah, and it was almost like, this is what we've got. But you think about it, if you're, you know, 17, 18 year old, not many of them players graduate into, you know, like a championship first team. And all of a sudden now we've got maybe six or seven that can all move up together as one. And, you know, you look at teams of the past, I know it's a ridiculous comparison to make at this stage, but like your Man United, their youth team almost became their first team.
Yeah.
And we've got a decent track record in youth team at Town, you know, when you look back over the last couple of seasons. So if they can all, you know, chuck in one or two in, yeah, right. But if you can make six or seven all become first team regulars, they've played together for maybe five or 6 years.
I think it's getting them right loans, and it's like Cowley's been quite banging on about the loan, getting them out on loan, playing man's football. It's about choosing the right loans for them, bringing them in at the right time, isn't it? Playing man's football, as they say.
I know it caused a lot of upset at the time, the changing of the youth system, but looking from the outside and without any emotion in it, it just looked the right move to me, that you bring people who are not quite making it at the bigger clubs, with the sort of catchment area that we're in. I know people disagree, but and I have no personal interest in it. It just felt like the right move. And if we've got five or six players on the bench in a championship game, perhaps that's proof of it. Yeah. Or perhaps
I think
it's
we
not.
Probably got discussed at the time, but just through working in junior football quite a lot, we've played in Huddersfield League at Gummersall, so obviously I see quite a lot of kids on a weekly basis, and it's quite a small pool to pick from. So if you're looking for sort of an under 11s and under 12s, under 13s, you've only got a few to pick from, because Man City come sniffing. You know, you see Sheffield United scouts on a regular basis, you see Man United scouts, you see Leeds. And as much as I'd love to have an academy from, you know, under 10s upwards, I think you're quite right. Is it better to cherry pick ones that have been, you know, let on? I can see Matt giving me evils here. Obviously feels differently, but at a club like Town, where we haven't got that much money to just...
Let the others do the hard work to 16. The only thing I would say, I think Town have always struggled 18 plus to get players through. They've always really struggled in knowing how to get players through. Mike Lillis wasn't a big fan of loaning players out. He wanted them all to come through together. Realistically, because you've done your FA level 1-2s and what have you, when you go through that, they talk about stragglers and strivers, don't they? Not everybody can come through at the same time. You know, they all come through at different levels. So men's football and loaning them out, letting them grow up is a huge part in what I believe to be key. Yeah. And I think that the current bunch, you know, Mark Hudson in his role, Lee Bromby, Dean Whitehead for what he did, John Worthen, I think they've cracked it to a degree. I really like what they're doing with, they have development games, they have serious games, they have tour games, they have all these different types of games, and they set different challenges to players, they move them into different positions, and I really like that. The only thing that I'm concerned about at the minute is when you look at the bench, Ben Jackson, Matty Daly, Josh Osterfield, not sure about Romani Edmonds-Green. I think he came in at 16, so he might have done it. But Ryan Schofield, 90% of these kids came through below the age group we are allowed to recruit for. So technically, we would have missed them. So we've got to find a way to make sure that we're not going to get those kids through again. So, but we do seem to have a plan. You know, Phil Hodgkinson said that he's happy to pay for them, and they've paid for the kid Luke Daly from Port Vale. They've got Ben Midgley's come through from Blackburn, released from Blackburn. He's come through, Murfield lad.
Diarra, isn't it? Or something like French lad.
Brahima Diarra, the French lad. They've brought a few lads over from Holland and all over. So I think I think for me, I'm in a wait and see mode. Yeah. I have a concern in that the recruitment for these players that are playing now was done at 9, 10, 11, 12, and Matty Daly 13, 14 with Ben Jackson. That's my concern, is that we could miss those, but we have a chairman and recruitment team who seem willing to buy players from other clubs. I think we bought someone from Wrexham as well recently. So I was a lover of the academy, involved with it, but I'm happy to sort of see how it goes, you know, and see how it goes. And you can't judge it after 1 or 2 years.
I think a decision like that is just 10 years. It's going to be
five, 10 years.
Where we are in 10 years.
I know absolutely nothing about this.
Well, Brentford have got it working, haven't they? Brentford do exactly the same. They've been doing it a bit longer.
They're different than they've been in London, so they've probably got like your Chelsea, your Arsenal's, your Tottenham.
Brentford have a B team as well, so they don't recruit technically from 16 up. They just have the B team, which is the EDT, you know. So they don't. But the thing is that the youngsters they bring in, because you can technically bring them in from 16, 17 because they're adults in a certain way. So they bring them in early and they're in the EDT team, but they do similar and, you know, the kind of games and they go to foreign training camps. And it is really interesting in what they do. And I think it could be the future for a lot of teams. And I think Huddersfield as an early adopter will benefit, but may miss out if they can't bridge that other gap with the youngsters. But we'll see how it goes, because Phil seems pretty switched on with it from when I spoke to him on this podcast. And they've got some really good people. Lee Bromby's a very clever guy as well. I know Lee Bromby. Went to school with Lee Bromby as well. So,
I didn't realise John Worthington was there. So
yeah, he's under 17's coach.
This,
yeah.
I do apologise.
I'll tell him when I see him tomorrow night at training.
He's a nice guy, is John Worthington.
He's so weird coaching with John Worthington, though, because he used to be like one of my favourite ever players. Yeah. And for a few weeks, it was like,
gingers together.
John Worthington there. Yeah, look at him. I love him.
In all seriousness, I love him.
Now he just gets
John
into big guns.
He's just a normal lad from Gummersall, isn't he?
He's a really nice lad.
I did like watching him.
Yeah, let's move on to James Bentley. This is a three tweets here. I'll rifle through these, and this is bringing back to Elias Kachunga, which I think these tweets are good, strong, but good in many ways. So James Bentley at Chromosomed. That's an interesting one. Chromosome D, even. I might have just made a complete mistake. And he says, I've seen negativity. I know, one pint, I'm all over the place. Look what happens. I've seen negativity around Cash recently. What are your thoughts? Should he start? To me, he adds value in work rate, positivity and experience. I agree 100%. If not goals. An example versus Leeds was when Harrit was getting grief. Elias was straight in with him, arm around him, helping the youth. And Danny Simpson's really great at that as well. Danny Simpson's a fantastic a leader with the other kids. And we've got George Stross, or George S. Stross, or S.T. Ross, 92. He says, Elias Kachunga, one of the worst players ability-wise at the club in the last 24 months, offers little but works very hard and clearly loves Huddersfield Town. If we spent $3 million, for example, on a new right winger, would we create more chances, more goals? I can't fathom how he's in the team each week. I don't hate him as much as some, but it's just frustrating to watch. Elements of Bocan versus Lincoln about him, and not just occasionally. It's week in, week out, yet Cowley still picks him. DW loved him too. Is there something us fans aren't aware of? And the overriding bit I will say about Danny Cowley and Elias Kachunga is one word, and that's trust. In that you can send Elias Kachunga out on the pitch and you can trust him for 90 minutes to never switch off, to constantly do the job of which you need him to do. He will work hard for the team. He will track back. He will do everything he possibly can to win a game of football. And I think at the minute we're finding that value in players low. Not low, but maybe sort of half empty, we'll say. And I think players like Kachunga, in terms of what they bring, and not just on the field, but off the field, is a great guy. And my when we took my little boy to her first game, my wife chased him across the bridge for a picture. And he was so polite and nice in that, he was obviously trying to get away with his dad and a few others. And he was really nice. He took his time, and he's such a great guy. And if the ball comes across at Leeds United for an equaliser, there's one person that you want to score, and that's Elias Kachunga. He's genuinely a great guy. I know I sound like I'm in love with him, don't I? But he's genuinely a great guy. And I really want him to start banging goals in, and because it just could take a couple just for it to work out. And I understand why he's in the team, but I understand what George is saying. He's missed four or five sitters, you could maybe say. And it will drain. Some people aren't as sentimental as me, and that they will see the chances he's missing and just go, look, a bit more ruthless.
He played well last night.
Yeah.
He did okay.
He does that hard work.
Yeah. But it can be so frustrating.
There's no getting away from the fact that he does miss those chances that he wasn't, like George says, 2 years ago he wasn't really, the first championship season particularly, double figures.
Well, let's be honest, if them chances ever to come that season at championship, he'd have bagged them.
And he was good
in the confidence, isn't it? It's one of them, and especially to his head. I think it's one of them that, I think you hit it on the head, Matt, really. It's trust. He trusts him to do a job. And at the moment, who else have we got to fill that role?
Well, that's the thing. We'll go back to Bristol City, Martin, where you were there. Dear Carby and Stephen Chicken, who's, I think he's brilliant for Huddersfield Town, for the Examiner. Brilliant, yeah, brilliant writer. Not as good match reports as you, Martin, obviously, has been our official match reporter. But, sorry, Stephen. But essentially, Dear Carby, Stephen, it's a bit of a takedown article, but it was 100% accurate with And because he was taking someone down, he demonstrated it with pictures, you know, to make sure he wasn't going over the top. And he showed Diakabi didn't do this, didn't do that. And you can't trust someone. If, you know, against Blackburn, he was great first half against Blackburn, won a penalty against Stoke, came on, changed the game a little bit. You can't rely on him 90 minutes every week. No, that's the problem. And where Kachunga, you know what you're going to get.
You do. And I've sort of defended Diakabi in the past because I thought that he had a lot of potential with his pace. And from time to time, when he got on a run, you know, you were up off your seat. But that Bristol game is probably the last straw.
It's the watershed, like you said, isn't it?
Like Josh was saying about the managers, the Cowleys, they have to work with what they've got. And one of the stable presences in that team is Kachunga. For all his limitations, he's going to give you exactly what you want to get from him.
And let's go back to the Chesties. We were saying Leeds United are a barometer. You know, they've had players there for 4 or 5 years who know the role, know the job, know the club inside out. And to be honest, Kachunga's in that mould. You know, Stuart Dallas for Leeds, probably not the most glamorous player. Really nice, you know, I've seen a lot of him, really nice guy. Decent, you know, not a bad player, plays for Northern Ireland, et cetera, et cetera. He's probably not a first team regular, but he's solid. He's there all the time. He can be relied upon. And I see Kachunga as that kind of mould of player whereby if he goes, then people will miss him a lot more than what they think he will.
Yeah, and I think he can suffer from the fact that he's had some high profile misses of goals, which he should have scored.
The Stoke one, yeah, that was a bit.
Yeah, how about that?
Yeah. And the one against Leeds was probably bad. As you said, if he'd have flicked off his head, he'd have probably got in. And as you
too
said,
clean.
If he'd have scored against Leeds, then
it'd have been a hero. He'd have probably had to move, because I think he lives in Leeds like me as well, so he'd have probably had to move for a bit. But, yeah.
But it would be nice to see Kachunga moving back into being a squad player following the transfer market in January, so that they still have them there to rely on. But we do have something.
We have someone else
different.
We can maybe bring on if he's not having.
I think that's the thing, isn't it? For all of his like misgivings, and he has missed his chances. Who else have we got in the squad who's going to do that role?
Absolutely,
exactly.
Who else can Danny Cowley trust to put on that pitch, give 100%, work hard, track back, do his defensive side? There's no one else.
Would you put Isaac Mbenza on?
Exactly.
Would you put Diakabi on? No.
Well, that was one of the
I'd put you on
strange.
Over Isaac and Benzo.
Mate, I won't last 5 minutes. I'm so unfair.
that was one of the most strange substitutions from the Cowleys that I've seen, bringing Diakabi on when we had two temporary fullbacks. I found that very odd.
Yeah.
Whereas
that came
Kachunga,
back and, bit us a absolutely. Little bit, didn't it? Yeah.
But with Kachunga, you know that he's going to protect that inexperienced fullback.
Yeah, 100%.
To me, Kachunga is a bit like your favourite shirt that you used to wear when you were 18 on night out on pull. You know, you go back to it because it's comfy, keeps you warm. But in this day and age, it's not going to get you a bird, is it?
Do you live with him as well? Is this exactly?
No, do you know what I mean? Though? It's like that old faithful that you put your trust in. And
he's not going to get you a bird.
No, well, you know what I'm saying? He's there, he does what he needs to do. He's not glory. You know, all right, we'll all look back with... You know, on
so
that season, they were unbelievable.
Bad joke alert. So you're not saying he's not a wingman, is that what you're saying?
I like that one, yeah. I think he's one of them. He's probably just gone past his best, but he still brings something to the team. But yeah, if we can bring someone in to play that role, he's probably one of them where
you want to rotate him in, don't you?
You'd start a Diakabi himself, but a Diakabi type, a bit more flat. Maybe a Josh Caroma at start. You look to get into the game, maybe get 1 or 2 nil up, and then with 15 to go, if you need to bring someone on to shut up shop, you bring your Kachungas on. I think that's where
he's flexible as
sort
well.
Of sits now within our squad. He's not going to get you the goals that you need to
he's
win
almost
games,
like
but
a
useful, he'd be a useful squad player,
him.
Wouldn't he? He fills what, two or three different roles, doesn't he? Yeah. Play up front, play behind, play wide.
He probably will be once the Cowleys can bring in.
I think like we've all said, he's in the team because there's nobody else.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah. So the last questions we've got, so they're both interlinked a little bit from Andy Moore and at MDA Terrier Mark. And they both talk about the youth as well. So Andy Moore says, is it unfair to replace some of the academy lads with January signings from what we haven't seen? And Should we do that? Mark says pretty much the same thing with him wanting to reduce the squad size to 22 in the emergence of the youth. Do the lads think we will see minimal incomings? And connected to that, do they think the youth are good enough to keep us out of trouble this year, or will they disappear back on loan come January? So, questions about the youth there. Josh, I'm putting you as the youth expert on this question.
It's hard to say, isn't it? Because, like I said, they're in there at the moment because they really need to be in there.
We also don't really know how good they are as well, to a point.
And we don't know how good they are. They could turn out, say, Matty Daly might kick on now, scored that goal, you know, I mean, get a bit more game time. We don't know how good he could be. Same with a couple of the lads. I don't think it should affect what we do in January. I think in January we need a buy for also now and for the future.
We need a left back.
We need a left back.
Sorry, Flo, but Jaden Brown's injured.
We need a bolster the squad. We need new face in there. We need to ship people out. But then
that's
we've got
not
these
a slight
coming
on Flo
in
as well. It's just that we're light on numbers. You know.
We need really players, don't we? We've got one recognised left back really, in what Jaden Brown, and that's it.
And then centre backs. You know, Elphick's out for a year. If Stankovic is injured, we've got Rahmani Edmonds-Green, who probably won't go back on loan at this time. Who did really well at Charlton. We haven't really mentioned it, but he had a really solid game.
Out of position as well.
Out of position. Bromley, I think Bromley said they played him across the back for midfield, so that's obviously been a really useful loan. I think Romani will probably stay, but some of them may go out, and some of them who haven't gone out, like Kean Harrott and Josh Osterfield, may go out.
I think one of the main things, sorry to cut you off, Matt, is we've just got to get to end of season, and however that happens, you might not agree, you might not, but we've just got to get to end of the season. And if that means we have to bring in three or four loan players, however many you can bring in, and these guys have to wait another 6 months, that's just how it has to be.
Yeah.
I don't feel confident. I've never seen them play, so I don't know.
Young lads as well.
They can't say they were
17-year-old.
If you're scrapping end of season, you need 6 points from last three games, do you want 5 or 6, 17, 18-year-olds.
Sometimes the fearless youth factor is good, but mostly you need your experience.
When the pressure's really on, at the minute there's not much pressure.
Absolutely,
there's a little bit because we're down there. But you want to get all of a sudden when it's really on and you need to win.
Yeah,
you want to get safe and then drip feed them into the team, them give them your minutes. You don't want to rely on them in a
first team squad members. They do everything as a first team squad member, and then let's see. As much as I enjoy seeing them, let's just get to end.
I also think you need to bridge a gap to the first team. I've just said earlier that loans are really important to grow up, and I think those that haven't been on loan do need to go out on loan as well. So I think a lot of them will go back out on loan. I think what might confuse people is that if we do get three Premier League loans, they're likely to be young lads as well. And some people will probably say, why are we bringing in young lads from here, there and everywhere to improve them for someone else and when we've got our own kids? But if we do that, the fact will be that these players coming in are deemed to be better quality. And therefore, you know, like your Izzy Browns and Casey Palmers, etc.
Just that little step above at the moment in the development, Mark.
Yeah, there's a lad called Billy Gilmore at Chelsea who's about 17, 18, would be a cracking number 10. I think he's ready for somewhere like
that. The thing is with loans that always worries me is you've got two types of loans. You've got your loan, like we had in the past, your Izzy Browns, your Casey Palmers.
I would take him back permanently if he was available.
I think he's available in the summer.
I'd take him back. We should have bought Izzy Brown and Casey Powell. They should have been the first.
I feel really bad for Izzy because he's just had a great spell at Luton and then he's got injured with a hamstring, hasn't he? But there's that nagging doubt. He's injured again.
That's his downfall, isn't it?
Yeah, so it's a risk. I got revenge, didn't I?
They kind of came and really wanted to be part of it and they got involved and it were almost like they were Huddersfield Town players. Then you look at your Shalabar, and for me, he's hot and cold. Does he want to be here? Is he that bothered? Grabara, he's a decent keeper, but I look at him and his attitude. All right, last night he ran length at field to celebrate.
I think he wants to be here. I just don't think we've found his niche properly yet. Maybe, I think that might be more to do with that. I think he's a good footballer.
They've got to want this. What I'm saying is if they're coming on loan, they want to be on loan. It's not a case of
Liverpool sending them
out going, go help Little Huddersfield out because they need some help. Yeah, so they come in thinking, I'm better than all you lot.
So if you bring in someone I'm probably doing this lad a disservice, but Rian Brewster, because you've said Liverpool, striker, we might need another striker. Rian Brewster, really highly regarded. Josh, you know all about him. England under 17s, 19s, really good finisher. Bring him in, like Eddie Nketiah maybe, who's at Leeds, that kind of player. He comes in. I don't know anything about his personality, but if he comes in and thinks, I'm a Liverpool player, I'm just here to tread water until I go back to Liverpool. That's not what you want, and that's what you're saying.
He wouldn't be there in the first place, though, would he, if he was like
exactly.
That.
They'd have bombed him out
by
now.
Seems unlikely.
I
don't think there's any sentiment. I mean, we've talked about Josh Kamara, and he has had good performances. But he's got, they've got to be kept up there, and they tend to dip. And it's no fault of their own. It's just how
peaks and troughs always happen.
Yeah. Young and inexperienced lads, isn't it? That's what it's going to happen, isn't it?
They've got to be allowed to get their own players. And that's what will happen. I don't think there's any doubt that's what will happen.
I think maybe we need some experience a little bit in certain areas as well. I can imagine the Cowleys will probably, like Lyle Taylor, we mentioned Lyle Taylor, someone like him up front. I know we've got Fraser Campbell, and you don't want to overload with too many sort of older ends here and there, but you look at players like that, and I know Charlton probably won't let him go and he'd probably cost a lot of money, et cetera, et cetera. It's just a for instance.
But I think he's behind the striker where we'll need to look a lot.
Yeah. I think actually sometimes when you look on paper, it's front four. And actually, you know, decent. If you can start with, like, say, Campbell up front.
You forget Grant Alex Pritchard, don't Pritchard you?
Pritchard's never fit, though. That's right, the problem. We can't see him put him out on the pitch at the same time, though, can we? That's the thing.
Everything's going to be about balance, isn't it? Balance it, trying to rebalance a team that is just completely out of kilter.
Yeah, and Danny Kelly has made a reference to that twice, hasn't he, that the squad is so imbalanced. And I think that's what we'll see. We'll see a redressing of the balance, if you like, using cliches here, aren't I? So we'll see that. I think we'll call it that for tonight, guys, unless you've got anything else that you want to do. No, fantastic. Poz is ready for bed, I think.
I'm not going to be coaching under sixes, mate. I'm absolutely sure.
Maybe
some of them could do a job instead of Flo.
You know, we're getting players younger in. You know,
we'll have to sign them at six, I don't know.
No. No one's allowed to sign at six, but there we go. So we've just put a competition up online. So those people, if you do want to win 24 beers, courtesy of Magic Rock, we have tweeted out a competition. Anybody affiliate with the podcast is unfortunately not allowed to join. So I've just hooked you guys in for the first time.
Is that why it's a week out win? So you've got three
I'm eliminating the competition here. But anybody affiliated with us is sadly not allowed to do it. However, if you caption the Tommy Smith wearing a turkey on his head well enough and make me laugh and other people laugh, or it's a good one, then you've got a very good chance of winning some quality craft ale, if you like. So 24 mixed, it'll be a mixed pack, so get that in. So I think the competition will finish on the 18th at just under 2 p.m. Get involved with that, retweet it. People probably don't want to retweet if they want to win it, but we would appreciate it if you do. Thanks to Magic Rock for having us tonight. It's been great here.
It's really nice, actually.
I've quite enjoyed it tonight. Keep subscribing, sharing, retweeting, it all helps. Thank you very much for stepping in for the other guys. I might have been a good night. So thanks, Josh, thanks, Dan, and thanks, Martin, for coming in.
Cheers, Matt. No problem.
And we'll be back again sometime soon.
There's a team that is dear to its followers. The colours are bright blue and white. They're a team of renown. They're the pride of the town, and the game of football is their delight. And all the while, upon the field of play, thousands loudly cheer them on the way. Often you can hear them say, who can beat the town today? And then the bells will ring so merrily, and every goal shall be a memory. So town, play up and bring that cup back to Huddersfield. So town, play up and bring the cup back to Huddersfield.